कारें डरती हैं और बाकी लोग भी डरते हैं. नेहा दीक्षित जिन्होंने अभी एक ज़बरदस्त रिपोर्टिंग की असम से, असम की लड़कियों को उठाकर दूसरे राज्यों में कैसे ले जाया जा रहा है, उस पर जिस वजह से आउटलुक का संपादक बदलने का दबाव सरकार की ओर से आउटलुक पर पड़ा और संपादक बदल दिया गया. तो यह शुभ्रा गुप्ता जिनके कॉलम आप लगातार पढ़ते होंगे इंडियन एक्सप्रेस में और जो सिनेमा सिने क्रिटिक हैं, हम चारों को आमंत्रित कर रहे हैं स्टेज पर. स्पीकिंग ऑफ विमेन द लैंग्वेज ऑफ कंट्रोल बोलने के लिए ये गुफ्तगू के साथ हमारा कोलैबोरेशन है. गीता हरिहरन, नेहा दीक्षित, शुभ्रा गुप्ता, वृंदा ग्रोवर, ऋतु मेनन, प्लीज.
थैंक यू अपूर्वा. ऑफ कोर्स इट्स ऑब्वियस आई एम नॉट स्वरा भास्कर डिस्पाइट द नेम, बट इट्स ऑल्सो ऑब्वियस दैट नन ऑफ अस इज अ फिल्म सेलिब्रिटी, इवन दो शुभ्रा इज क्लोज टू बीइंग वन. And so we are not vulnerable in the same way as the previous panelist mentioned, but we are vulnerable in other ways, and we are vulnerable in very diverse ways, which is what I think we will all be trying to address this afternoon. So the panel is titled Speaking of Women, the Language of Control, and in Speaking of Women, we will be speaking at this session about the language of film, Shubhra, the language of law, Vrinda, and how language is used and manipulated in all media. I have to say, though, that in addition, just before we begin, that in addition, of course, to the introduction that Apoorva Nand gave, all of us on this panel, in addition to doing what we do, in our working lives and in our professional lives, are also very active in the public domain and intervene in the public domain. So it is from that experience and that that perspective that we will be speaking about the language of control. So all these languages of film, of journalism, and of law, that is to say, by journalism I mean all media, and law will be linked to what I'm now calling a resurgent patriarchy. It's not a word that's used very often these days, but I think it's a word that we need to bring back into some sort of circulation, especially now. And by resurgent, what do I mean? I mean a very evident and a very palpable rise in masculinism of all kinds and in all domains and in many, many areas of expression and activity and suppression and control. I think that this will be addressed by everybody, so I won't elaborate too much on it. But I think that along with a resurgent patriarchy, it is almost inevitable that there is a rise in what I call masculinism. Why resurgent? Patriarchy hasn't disappeared. It's very much around. But when there is a very sharp turn towards the right in politics and in economics, in the economic sphere and the political sphere, as there has been over the last, certainly this century, and accentuated now in the political domain, patriarchal control is consolidated in the social and cultural domains as well. So although it has never disappeared, it is resurgent, and resurgence gives it another kind of authority. Old patriarchy, or shall we say unreconstructed patriarchy, was sort of unabashed in its use of the language of control, meaning there was no Nobody was apologizing for it. Nobody was rationalizing it. Nobody was pretending it didn't exist. It existed and it was used. And it was unabashed. But resurgent patriarchy has a problem today. And the problem is that you cannot be seen to be openly advocating the suppression and repression of women. Nobody can. No political party will say it, no social activist will say it, no public person will say it, no corporate group will say it. They will be bending over backwards to prove how egalitarian they are, how much they care about women, how they do their damnedest to make sure everything is equal. Nobody will openly espouse. So as I said, in the unreconstructed patriarchy, there was no need to apologize for using the language of control. But now, what we have in its place is equivocation. You will say one thing in public and do something quite different in private. You will have one kind of policy which becomes policy, and your implementation and your action will be quite different. You will have one rhetoric for public consumption, and you will have a quite different practice when you begin to practice. This equivocation then makes it very difficult for there to be any kind of any kind of direct attack, either by those who are being attacked. And of course, what it does is it makes denial very possible for those who are equivocating. They can always deny. They can always deny that there is something reprehensible about what they're doing, because that is the nature of equivocation. So the way that we are going to sort of have this conversation is that I will, rather than having everybody sort of hold forth for their 10 or 12 or whatever minutes we have, I'm going to try and do something slightly different, and I hope it works. I hope for all of us that it works. I'm going to pose a few questions to everybody, to all of the panelists, and ask them to actually respond from their experience, based on their experience, and also perhaps to converse with each other. So the first question, of course, is for everyone. And it is this. Would you say, all of you, Neha and Vrinda and Shubhra, would you agree with this proposition that this equivocation is now something that is very much a part of the public discourse? Would you, if you do agree, if you don't agree, of course you will say why you don't agree, but if you do agree, would you say that it confounds your practice?
Everybody here, hello. I'm going to keep breaking into Hindi and Angrezi, because this, I find talking about Hindi cinema in English a little bit, have always found it a little problematic. So I keep breaking into Hindi and English. So jisko agar Hindi mein thodi si bhi takleef ho, aap haath utha kar de, to fir main koshish karungi ki Angrezi mein wapas usi ko bolu. Mere hisab se main filmon pe bahut saal se likh rahi hoon. और मैंने जहाँ तक देखा है जो एक लैंग्वेजिंग होती है सिनेमा की, और इसमें मैं सिर्फ हिंदी सिनेमा की बात करूँगी क्योंकि वो मेरा सिनेमा है. मैं और किसी भाषा के बारे में इतना नहीं जानती. आई डोंट नो टू मच अबाउट अदर लैंग्वेज सिनेमास. बट इन विद इन दैट वॉट वी हैव एंड स्टिल हैव, दीज आर प्रीडोमिनेंट ट्रोप्स. मैं 16 बरस की, तू 17 बरस का, एक लड़का एक लड़की. ये 2016 में अभी भी हम जब फिल्म देखते हैं तो हमारे प्रीडोमिनेंट ट्रोप्स जो होते हैं वो सिर्फ ये होते हैं, 16 साल के, 17 साल के लड़का और लड़की, जिसमें पुरुष और महिला, मैन एंड वुमन की कहीं बात ही नहीं होती है. अगर होती है तो वो सीधी फिल्म जाके ए कैटेगरी में डाल दी जाती है. क्यों, अभी तक मुझे समझ में नहीं आया है. हम लोग यहाँ पर सब लोग हैं जो 18 साल के ऊपर हैं. हम लोग वोट दे सकते हैं, हम लोग शादी कर सकते हैं, हम लोग वी कैन हैव चिल्ड्रन, बट वी कैन नॉट सी ourselves, play ourselves on screen. To me, that is a very difficult proposition. But I will also say that in terms of what equivocation that you were talking about, Hindi cinema actually has been fighting back. Thode thode jaga, thode thode spaces mein वापस एक पुश किया जा रहा है और वो जो पुश है वो सिग्निफिकेंट है कि जो पिछले दो तीन चार पाँच साल में पिछले दस साल में ऐसी फिल्में आई हैं ऊपर उभर के जहाँ पर वी आर सीइंग द प्रिविलेजिंग ऑफ मेन एंड वुमेन वी आर सीइंग द फैक्ट दैट द लैंग्वेज ऑफ कंट्रोल इज़ बीइंग पुश्ड बैक सो मेरे हिसाब से जो प्रीडोमिनेंट रहा है 100 साल के सिनेमा में वो तो है ही है लेकिन जो अलग हो रहा है उस पर थोड़ी सी अगर बात करी जाए तो वो इस तथ्य को थोड़ा आगे बढ़ाएगी
आई डोंट नो whether Neha एंड Vrinda विल अग्री विद दैट आई मीन आई हैव अ पर्टिकुलर क्वेश्चन दैट आई विल पुट टू Shubhra अबाउट दैट बट मे बी Neha एंड Vrinda कैन स्पीक फ्रॉम देयर प्लेस एज वेल
Thank you, Ritu. I would like to give some specific examples when you say that resurgent patriarchy. किस तरह से repackaging होती है उसकी बहुत ही अच्छी सी scientific भाषा में उसके दो तीन example देना चाहती हूँ. Yeah. I used to work with a magazine and I had done a story on human trafficking and that included bride trafficking and all the placement agencies and blah blah blah. So during the annual conference. The marketing team came and said कि ये मैगजीन कैसे बिकेगी आप तो ये कटी फटी औरतों की फ़ोटो कवर पर लगा देते हैं सो वाइल वी आर रिपोर्टिंग वेरी सीरियसली एंड डेडिकेटिंग लाइक 12,000 वर्ड्स टू दैट पर्टिकुलर इशू दिस इज़ वॉट द मार्केटिंग डिपार्टमेंट थिंग्स नाउ आई विल गिव अनदर एग्जाम्पल आई वॉज वर्किंग विद अ टीवी चैनल एंड अ बिग कॉर्पोरेट ग्रुप हैड bought a significant chunk in the organization I was working for and the marketing team did some research so we had a 45 minute session with our editor the entire editorial team in which the editor told us that from now our target audience is the urban rich so the prototype would be a 35 year old techie sitting in Bangalore so each time we report a story The branding should of the show or the report should be according to his taste. The headline should be according to his liking. And this editor went on for 45 minutes about he should switch to the channel and he should do this and he should do that. So after this briefing, he said that any questions. So I said, is there a she? So the executive editor of this channel said this in front of 70 people from the edit team. That scientific research suggests that women do not watch television news as much, so there is no she. And on top of that, as if this answer was not a disaster enough, one of the producers said, so why do we have women anchors? So the editor replied saying, they're also for the 35-year-old techie. So 35-year-old techie, so that he should switch to the channel. Then there is this third category, which we were told, who's this? The target audience for this particular newspaper is Neha Chadda in Lajpat Nagar. So the idea is, we were told that Neha Chadda in Lajpat Nagar only reads about films and iPhones. So that is why this broadsheet newspaper will only have things for Neha Chadda. So. What I'm trying to say is that while they don't say it directly, but they always have this quote-unquote scientific research to suggest that things shouldn't be done in a particular way, and they keep reinforcing all these things that we fight against.
Go ahead, go ahead.
Ritu, the way I would look at it is that I think resurgent patriarchy and unconstructed patriarchy are both subsisting alongside. I don't think we've got rid of one even in the public discourse. I think it's very much there. And when you look at law, I think there is a reason why it stays there. Because law, as we know, it's setting the normative standards, it's setting the code of life, it's setting what is prohibited conduct, what is not. Now, if resurgent patriarchy, even for the purposes of equivocation, was to capture the domain of law or capture the domain of dispensation of law, a dispensation of justice, that would create a huge problem because it would then actually destabilize the domains where patriarchy is resting. And I think therefore, while we see in a lot of public speak, we see in articles, etc., there are observations which are made. I just want to refer to a judgment, and this was given this year by the Supreme Court. It's not old, it's not coming from some obscure place where they don't know what is happening. And you know, we just had people discussing that post 2012 things have changed. I think both coexist and seem to coexist quite comfortably when it comes to families, marriage, which are really the gut of patriarchy. I think there nothing much has changed. It's a judgment that was discussed and critiqued by the media also. It's a divorce case where the husband has alleged cruelty against the wife. And I think what's important is the language that the court uses is actually very, very important to understand, particularly as you mentioned that with the swing towards the right, all this does become more prominent. So I'm just reading from the middle of the judgment. With regard to the allegations of cruelty leveled by the appellant, which is who's the husband, we are in agreement with the trial court. First of all, let us look at the incident with regard to an attempt to commit suicide by the respondent, who is the wife. Upon perusal of the evidence of the witnesses, the findings arrived at by the trial court that the wife had locked herself in bathroom and had poured kerosene on herself so as to commit suicide are not in dispute. Fortunately for the appellant, not for the respondent, because of the noise and disturbance, even the neighbors of the appellant rushed to help and the door of the bathroom was broken open and the respondent was saved. Had she been successful in her attempt to commit suicide, then one can foresee the consequences and plight of the appellant, because in that event, the appellant would have been put to immense difficulties because of the legal provisions. We feel that there was no fault on the part of the appellant, nor was there any reason for the respondent wife to make an attempt to commit suicide. No husband would ever be comfortable with or tolerate such an act by his wife. And if the wife succeeds in committing suicide, then one can imagine how a poor husband would get entangled into the clutches of law, which would virtually ruin his sanity, peace of mind, career, and probably his entire life. The mere idea with regard to facing legal consequences would put a husband under tremendous stress. The thought itself is distressing. Such a mental cruelty could not have been taken lightly. The second ground, of course, on which the cruelty is upheld, I'll just read from the middle. It is not a common practice or desirable culture for a Hindu son in India to get separated from the parents upon getting married at the instance of the wife, especially when the son is the only earning member in the family. A son brought up and given education by his parents has a moral and legal obligation to take care and maintain the parents when they become old. In India, generally, people do not subscribe to the Western thought, where upon getting married or attaining majority, the son gets separated from the family. In normal circumstances, a wife is expected to be with the family of the husband after the marriage. She becomes integral to and forms part of the family of the husband, and normally without any justifiable strong reason, she would never insist, etc., etc. A son maintaining his parents is absolutely normal in Indian culture and ethos. And it goes on to say that, you know, in a Hindu society, it is a pious obligation of the son to maintain the parents.
But I don't know why you don't say this is equivocation.
What I'm saying is that this is the Supreme Court in 2016. And that's where we are with a resurgent patriarchy. It is. That's what I'm saying. Yeah. It is resurgent patriarchy. Mm. But the resurgent patriarchy is actually resting very comfortably on the the way patriarchy has always been.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah, yeah, of course.
That's exactly my point, that when we talk about resurgent, the use of the word resurgent itself, I am questioning. Okay. Because resurgence means that it has gone away, or it is under somewhere, or it is resting someplace. Resurgence, matlab yahan se leke yahan tak, it's never gone. It's always been in our face. There's never in these last, all these years that I've been actually, I'm looking at it through the prism of cinema and how cinema looks at life and how when we live that life and then we signal back to the film that this is what we want to watch or not want to watch. When we have women who have agency, right? How many of us actually watch those movies? How many of us say, hey, that's the kind of woman I want to watch. That is the kind of film that I will put my money where my mouth is. I will go watch that film. I will plonk that $250 on the box office. No, we will go and watch Bajrangi Bhaijaan, which itself is not such a bad film. But we will go and see some other, like Kick, for example. Kya hai wo film?
Pink.
Wo ek Salman Khan ki film hai. Salman is a great star. I just want to
pink.
Wrap it up very
you
quick.
You said Pink.
No, I said...
No, did you say Pink?
No, I said Kick. There's okay. 2 saal pehle Salman Khan ki ek film aayi thi, uska naam tha Kick. That film has nothing but Salman showing up with his agate blue bracelet. And whenever he shows up, everybody erupts because nobody wants to watch him do anything other than that. He's who he is. Now, if you see something like Pink, for example, now Pink, I think, is a wonderful film. Is an absolutely wonderful film, and I don't care whether it is Amitabh Bachchan who comes to the rescue of these girls. I don't care. Okay, because that is a side issue. What is important is that these women all say
women
what
clapping.
We need to say and what we need to hear, and they say it. And it doesn't matter that old gentleman playing the way he did. He was the face that got us into the theater. Not one of us would have bought a ticket if it hadn't been for Bachchan's name. But it's all right. It's okay. The filmmaker has to do what the filmmaker has to do. We as aware and engaged audiences, what we have to do is to, our takeaway is no means no. And so, I think for that, I don't care what kind of equivocation there is. And I am still contending that there is no resurgence, there is no equivocation. We have patriarchy in our face every single day from our waking morning. Even our very liberal partners and spouses and families that we live in, when you step out, they say, acha, kahan jana hai? Excuse me, I could have like 10 different things to do, but no, I have to justify the fact that I have this to do, that to do, but why? When a man can just walk out of the house not having to say anything at all, kyun? Ye hamari filmon mein bhi hota hai, ye hamari apni zindagi mein bhi hota hai. And that is why I feel that when we talk about patriarchy, which exists, we are just going round and round the same loop. What we have to do is to talk about those artifacts, whether they are in film or in literature or somewhere, which have broken away, which are breakthroughs, and then see how they've constructed it. So and whether if that's problematic, then we talk about that and say how we can walk past it. You know, what we are saying, we are all against patriarchy in some form or the other. We know what we are talking about. Most of us. Okay, raise the hands. People who say that patriarchy is in the bad. Bolo. Koi hai yahan pe? Nobody.
That's my, Shubhra, that's my point. Nobody will here will raise their hand and say we are for patriarchal control. Nobody will say it. That's the equivocation, but they will go home and say, maa ne karwa chauth ke ka vrat rakha ke nahi rakha?
Kaun bolega yahan pe karwa chauth ke baare mein? Maine kiya, kisi ne kiya, sab ne kiya. Agar apni marzi se kiya, bahut achha kiya.
No, 1 minute,
Shubhra.
Agar kisi ne
zabardasti se kiya, okay.
So where is the breakthrough then? Where is the break? No, one moment.
Okay.
Two things.
Rhetorical question?
No, not a rhetorical question. It's a real question. Now, of course, because cinema is such an important medium and has become a kind of vehicle for a lot of messaging, let's say, even if it's sort of somewhat liberating, somewhat problematic, somewhat breakthrough, whatever it is, it isn't a single message. There is no film which has pretended to be a breakthrough film. Let's take Pink, let's take Salam Namaste, let's take so many films. Salam Namaste, I mean, this woman is pregnant outside of wedlock, first time in Hindi cinema. But even these films don't have a single message. They have a subliminal message which is reinforcing in very many unmistakable ways. That's what I mean by equivocation. I don't mean that it is a straightforward sort of denial or a straightforward assertion.
Sure.
Okay?
I just want to respond to that, and then I will let you ladies take on. When you talk about cinema and clear messaging, you know what happens with mainstream cinema? There are constraints of many kinds. When the scriptwriter is looking to create a woman who is different, I feel that unless the man is different, the woman will never be different. You have to have a hero who is different for the woman, for the heroine to be different. And that, unless that happens, it's not going to happen. That's one. And the fact that even these messaging, even this much, that there is a woman out of wedlock, her belly out to there, wearing a smock, not a sari, saying, "Mujhe Ben and Jerry ice cream khana hai." Oh my God, I mean, really, that was a moment for Hindi cinema. It doesn't matter how much of a subliminal message later, ki haan bhai shaadi kar lena. Ye jo bina shaadi kare bachche paida karna bahut buri baat hai. Haan, wo sab hai, lekin wo baad mein aata hai. उसको मैं काफी अच्छी तरह से उस लड़की को दिखाया है और उसके मतलब the way Preeti Zinta's character is portrayed is great and the other one I really want to bring out is the character of Queen. Kangana Ranaut plays Queen and that scene in which she is tripping down the road and when she just turns her back on this guy who says, "You know what? I'm ready to forgive you. Tum wapas aa jao. Main maaf kar deta hu tumko. Meri maa bhi tumko bilkul maaf kar degi." And she says, "You know what? I don't think so. Bye-bye." And she walks down the road. I think that is, again, I don't care how much equivocation is going around that. It is mainstream. It needs to go out in 500 screens, 1,200 screens. It needs to be a certain kind of artifact to be able to put those messaging in. If we go into the yes and no, then we become polemical. That is not mainstream.
No. I'm just saying that we are speaking about here a controlling language. No, and there are several levels of control. That's all that I'm suggesting.
I'm saying as audiences, I think what we have to train ourselves to see, to cut through all the layers and to see what we are going to take away from that is
fair
what
enough.
I'm saying.
But I don't know that it operates in, for instance, look at what has happened in Outlook with that RSS story that you did and the fallout of that. And yet Outlook presents itself as a progressive, forward-looking, and you know, I mean, a place where you will get to know that they will investigate what is happening. Now, where that control came from and why, or where certain other kinds of control are coming from in our other institutions, is to me the crux of this, the whole issue of equivocation. What does it mean in our practice? I don't know, if Shubhra were a filmmaker instead of film critic, you don't have to answer right now, but if you were, because a practitioner is vulnerable in a different way. So if you are in that medium, and if you are a journalist, if you are a lawyer, pleading, defending, drafting, working for change, in this equivocation, what happens to your practice?
Actually, thank you for asking this question, because while Shubhra was talking, I thought I'll bring this up. And before this panel also, we were having having a discussion with Geeta, that a lot of times I actually use, it's unfortunate and I hope I don't get lynched for saying this, but a lot of times I use patriarchy while I'm to my advantage when I'm out there reporting. For instance, when I go and interview the Khap Panchayat leaders, they anyway think that ye stupid ladki hai, isko kya pata hai. So I act that dumb, silly person who doesn't know anything, and it has actually happened that they end up telling me more than they would actually tell a male reporter. And similarly, you know, so these are at small levels you actually use it. The second thing that I want to bring up is that like for the RSS story, when I was in Gujarat, and out of those 31 girls, 20 girls were in Gujarat in Saraswati Shishu Mandir. The fact, the Saraswati, so basically I was talking to these girls from Assam and the people in Saraswati Shishu Mandir, they locked the gate and they said that we will not let you out. And because the my driver, the person who had, the taxi person was also from the local area and he was under the influence of this trustee of Saraswati Shishu Mandir, he also refused to drive off. So that's when this... later on, after a good one and a half hour session with the trustee of the Saraswati Shishu Mandir and with me explaining ki what am I doing actually, he said ki aap Brahman aurat hai, kuch galat to nahi karenge. And that's when he actually opened the door and he let me off. So I'm saying that at various levels, these at, you know, when you're out there on the ground, there are, I mean, there are various things that you actually fight against, but at the same time, you have to, it's a very conflicted existence at that point, that how are you actually going to contradict it, whether if I actually get into an argument with this person at that very moment, or shall I just come back and write an article and expose them in a better way? These are calls you often take. The second thing that happens is that, like, after this RSS story, and when an FIR was filed against me and the Outlook editor and the publisher for inciting communal hatred, what the right wing is actually very consistently doing is that it immediately turned the argument, and this issue became about freedom of speech instead of the criminalities and the misgivings of RSS. So what happened was that the journalist and the news organization became the story. The issue became about freedom of speech, and everybody is now talking about freedom of speech, and nobody is actually, I'm not saying nobody, but mostly people are not talking about what the RSS was up to and how they violated several international and national child rights laws.
But Neha, one very interesting thing about this conversion, this subversion of the focus away from the girls onto freedom of speech, this is part of the media's working, isn't it? Isn't it the media who did this as making it into a freedom of speech issue rather than an issue that is focusing on the RSS and their abuse of girls? Is this if not equivocation?
And actually you're right, because, and I think Vrinda will be a better person to answer this, because the example I would use is, for instance, the mass rapes of the Muzaffarnagar women. And Vrinda has been representing those seven women, and they were the only ones among so many women who were actually raped during the riots. Actually, one editor told me that they don't make for good TV, and that's why we don't have a debate. You know, the fact that he could say this. Second thing is, obviously, there is this, if the target audience is urban rich, there is that kind of bias that tribal girls or Dalit women are actually not represented. Reports about them do not find that kind of space on prime time or in the center spread of, you know, a magazine or a newspaper in that way. So, yes, there are those different biases also, that apart from gender, there is caste, class, religion, there are different parameters, the intersectionality of these oppressions that the mainstream media actually does not want to acknowledge, and that is the larger thing.
Yes, but they won't ever put it that way. They won't say we are not interested. I mean, they may, in editorial meetings, they may say it. But the public discourse is one of social justice, one of egalitarianism, one of liberalism, one of democracy, and so on and so forth. The actual practice is subverting that. So I'm saying that this is something that we see now as becoming more and more part of the environment in which we all work. So this paradoxical situation where, let's say, Deepika Padukone can get up and talk about her depression. What has made that possible? No, I'm not asking you a question. It is a rhetorical question. What has made it possible is, of course, years and years and years of work by a lot of very courageous women speaking up about this. And then one Deepika Padukone gets up and suddenly finds that she can talk about her depression, and it becomes a celebrity issue. Depression becomes a celebrity ailment, if you like. But the 99% of other depressives are still stigmatized. I dare say there will very quickly be a Hindi film about it. in no time at all, you will find an issue of mental health being taken up.
Can I just add to okay. what you said, Ritu? Because for instance, Deepika Padukone was also in this video of My Choice by Vogue, you know, this video that people have had several responses to it. And it actually coincided with the times when there were several deaths in sterilization camps. Several women were dying. And it is a fact that since 2002, at least, and it's a conservative estimate, that at least 20,000 women die every year in government hospitals during sterilization. So actually there is that class bias, that while she's saying that it's my choice, because obviously you can have access to contraceptive, while these women, they're not really, and the 20,000 women that I'm talking about have not been forcefully taken in a sterilization camp. It is because the Family Welfare Department only gives them that option freely available to those women, who are obviously from a marginalized socioeconomic background. So they willingly want to use contraceptive, and in that process they die. So the idea of choice and its portrayal in mainstream media has a lot to do with the class and caste intersections, I would say.
Vrinda, I want to ask you one thing, it's sort of leading off from Neha. This Khap Panchayat, a totally illegal setup. Completely, I don't know what word to use. There must be a legal term for it. It continues. There's no, as I say, no political party will come out openly and say these wretched things have to be outlawed. What is this?
No, obviously the political party won't. It's steeped in it itself.
No, but what about the legal establishment?
Right. Well, as they will tell you, the pat answer that comes is the police comes from the same lot that we come from. Well, so do the judges, actually. Nobody's dropping from Mars. I just want to break this into a couple of things. One, that what does one do when one is a practitioner within? And what is all this business of raising the issue, whether it's on mental health or it's on gender issues? What has it done to the larger issues? And the Khap Panchayat thing I'll address. I think when you're a practitioner, you are negotiating many, many things simultaneously. And as a lawyer, it's not just the lawyer negotiating, you're representing somebody. So obviously the conversation is with the client and what is in the greater interest of the client. It can't just be what the lawyer herself. But there is a negotiation. Yes, if a woman client smokes and would usually come to my office dressed in trousers or a dress, the day she has to speak, give her testimony in court, yes, there is a conversation about what she would wear. Because even though courts may be saying certain things, we all know how at a subliminal level all these things operate and all these prejudices and biases are alive and kicking amongst everybody. And so those are negotiations that one takes place. Although there is, it would be, if I were to look back the way one would engage with these issues 20, 25 years ago in my own practice, and the way one approaches it today, I think we have come a long way. And we have not come a long way because the courts have changed, or the judiciary has necessarily started thinking differently. We have come a long way because there is a lot of women on the ground, there are people on the ground who have pushed these ideas that this is all right. And that is where the beginning of change has taken place, and therefore you can today go in court and say, yes, I am not married, and yes, prior to this, I did have other sexual relationships, and insist that that is not something that should be held against her. But that's not the doing of the courts, and that Vardaan has not come from the courts under any circumstances. In fact, the bias is very much there. But when we talk of the equivocation that you are speaking of, I think the problem it's creating, and she mentioned about Muzaffarnagar, and I'm glad she mentioned this thing about they don't make good TV. Every time these women would come to meet me, they're coming out of their camps or wherever. I live in Delhi. For them, they're going to somebody's place. When you go to somebody's house, you wear your good clothes and you come. You don't come looking necessarily, you don't show that side of yourself to the whole world. That's a private grief that the family is coping with. And I remember there was somebody from BBC who wanted to do this, and I had asked them that the BBC will be coming. So they came in their best clothes. They came very well dressed. And I remember the director was totally rattled because, yes, they didn't look like raped women. And they didn't fit the bill of what he wanted to project as raped women of a communal conflict. And I think what all this is doing simultaneously is A, not allowing for certain important issues to be addressed. That, to my mind, is one of the biggest crises we've run into, particularly if I were to say around gender issues. Because everybody, as she asked, is anybody here in support of patriarchy? And nobody, I mean, we don't even know how people here, what they understand, interpret, think, analyze of patriarchy. But yes, maybe nobody will put up their hand in an audience at the Habitat. Maybe in another venue we could have a disagreement. But what is it doing to the issue is that the issues are not moving forward at all. Because these issues have been settled. These are women have now got everything, so we don't need to fight. And as she is very clearly saying, which women? And which women is this Hindi cinema talking about? And which women is law talking about? And what is happening to the lives of many, many, many women who are not at all part of this, but because we use generic language, we use overarching language, and we refuse to break down what is impinging on lives of different people, because then in that patriarchy, which is impinging on the lives of other women, many of us would be complicit. We don't want to break that down. And that is what this resurgent patriarchy is really doing.
I want to just break in after your, because the film, you mentioned the film thing. I would say two very quickly, I would say that when filmmakers really want to do something different, what they do is they couch it in a way that the difference, and yet there is not very much difference, because they are trying to hedge their bets all the time. There is always a problem.
Of course,
let me just finish. And the other thing is, when we have a public discourse which is created by, there is nothing called, by the way, the media, there is the press, there is the internet, there is the television, there are all of this which becomes, so when we have a public dominant discourse where women are not looked upon as at the same level, have never, and are still fighting, where political leaders can get up and address large gatherings by saying, Mahila tatha anya pichhade varg. Does everybody understand that line? Women and other lower denominations. This line has been used over and over and again for the last 70 years, 75 years. I've been hearing it in public discourse. People standing in front of my people who are netas talking about this. This seeps into our, it's not just into the body politic, it seeps into our receivers and our receptors. So when we are as audience, when we go into a theater and we look at something that is even slightly radical, we are not very comfortable. We are, that is to us, that radical. So I'm just, so when people, when filmmakers are actually striving for difference, they have to be very careful. They cannot go out on a limb because then nobody will come.
Lord, no, 1 minute, Shubhra. One minute. Yeah. I must interrupt you. A lot of people are making that difference. Yeah. They are stepping out. Filmmakers may not be doing it, but a lot of other people are. One moment. A lot of other people are. They're putting their necks on the line. Yeah. They are being unequivocal about what they're saying. Right. And they're doing it in the public domain.
I have to say that no defense for anybody. People who follow my work know that I'm very hard to please as far as films are concerned. But when they even try this much difference, you have to acknowledge the fact that there is difference and to see how that fits and how those things shift. There are things shift.
But you're assuming that other people don't take the risk.
I'm not saying that at all. I am not saying that at all. I'm just saying that in cinema, which is what you asked me to look at, and that is my prism, there are other people. The women who started were people like you and Urvashi, all of you, people who did work in the 70s. That's the reason why we are sitting here today.
So okay, I just want to end by, because we have been told to open it up. I just want to put one proposition before the audience for the questions. Is the language of control alive and well as far as speaking of women is concerned? Now, it's open to the audience based on whatever was discussed earlier by Shubhra, Neha, and Vrinda. It's open. Anybody can raise their hands.
Hi. Hi. This was a very valuable discussion. Thank you all for this. What I wanted to ask, when you were talking about equivocation, it sounded more like hypocrisy to me.
Like what?
Hypocrisy?
Something in public, something in private. What I'm really interested in the sense of the language of control is the insidious way in which certain words are used to really take away attention from very specific questions. So I'll take two examples. One is Chetan Bhagat's latest book. So he's talking about an average Indian girl, and he says women, girls have feelings, emotions, and so feminism is okay, it's on the side, but she's also a girl. So also comes in, she's also an average Indian girl with feelings and emotions, which probably feminists don't have, according to him perhaps. And the other is that Airtel ad, which I think raised a lot of controversy last year, where this woman who's her husband's boss orders him to work for very long, and then she goes back home and makes it up to him by cooking him like a lavish dinner kind of thing. So this is, I would say, these are two examples of the insidious way in which you try and soften the blow of feminism. That's what I just
wrote. Okay, so that's a comment, no? Not necessarily a question.
My question is for Shubhra about the fact that you kept saying that at least something is happening. And we've been hearing that for many years now, that people are doing something, But now, we've been 70 years old. We've started making movies before that. When will we talk about at least? Till when will we keep saying that at least they are doing something, at least they are doing something? When will we have cinema which really talks about the trials and tribulations of Dalit, Muslim, tribal women, when they will reclaim their spaces without having them being, enacted in relation to masculinity? And when will we stop saying this at least, and when will we start talking about real cinema with real women?
Okay, so I'm not saying at least at all. Not at least at all. What I'm trying to say is, yahan par jitne log baithe hain na, 150 log, agar inme se aap log mein se koi bhi, jo bhi koi jis din Shah Rukh ya Salman ki film aati, us din koi mat dekho jaake. Mat dekho. Us film ko aap boycott kar do na, to ye aapka jo, aapne jo sawal pucha hai na, that'll happen. All this business about, I really find this a little bit problematic about, and a little sanctimonious about, not targeting really, but asking these questions of filmmakers who have a process. Do we understand the processes with which they come to us and make their stuff visible? Do you understand that? Once you get behind that and you understand how that thing gets constructed, then we can engage in a slightly more fruitful question. I completely agree with you. I do believe that this at-leastism is really impossible. In 2016, we are talking about this. We're talking about patriarchy, for Christ's sake. In 2016, when it exists, it hasn't gone away. There's no resurgence. It's just because right now, what we have is the people in power are also behind this. And they are actually pushing it from below and above, and we are getting scrunched. There is no doubt about it. But when you're talking about, these are viewing practices. Let's change viewing practices. And then, because this is not a one-way street, right? For a film is not made in the ether. It's not made for invisible masses. It's made for you and me. The day you and me change our viewing practices, this is going to change. Okay?
The nature of law, the legal system, I know media shouldn't be all bracketed in one, so there's internet and there's press, but I'm just wondering, in the sphere in which you work, Vrinda, seems to be quite different from the sphere in which, and when Ritu talks about resurgent patriarchy, the kind of example you quoted, Vrinda, to my mind sounded like pretty conventional, approach of a patriarchy. I'm wondering, in a system where it's down to one lawyer fighting the case of one client to one judge, she's always talking about some invisible standards by which you have to keep judging yourself, either as a film critic or a maker or an actor. Swara kept, even in the way she was responding, there was always that invisible world. There's a standard being set. But with you, it's down to some male, female, it's all single lawyers who are interpreting the law. I still want to know, in the legal system, is there any room for what Ritu is calling the calling resurgent patriarchy, where people feel, no, I really must be politically correct here? You know, that there is now the atmosphere has changed. Ab ek dusri boli bolni padegi. चाहे मैं कुछ भी सोच रहा हूँ एक दूसरी बोली बोलनी पड़ेगी क्योंकि यू नो एटमॉस्फेयर कुछ बदल गया है आई जस्ट वांट टू नो मोर फ्रॉम यू हाउ इट वर्क्स इन द कॉरिडोर्स ऑफ कोर्ट्स
जस्ट वेरी क्विकली वन आई डोंट थिंक इट्स यू नो ऑफ कोर्स इट विल बी एन इंडिविजुअल लॉयर एड्रेसिंग अ केस टू अ बेंच द बेंच कैन ऑफ कोर्स बी मोर देन वन जज But I actually disagree with Shubhra when it, you know, it's as though here everybody can take their own call, but in the film industry, it's something else at play. I think it's about economics that she's hinting. And here also, if you decide to have a different kind of legal practice, it has economic consequences, which is what I think Ritu is saying when she's saying people do face the consequences or Neha faces the consequences as a journalist, as a media practitioner. So I think that operates across professions. But yes, when you talk about that, are they conscious and is there an equivocation that is being resorted to? Yes, there is. The best part is it slips away. Equivocation does not stay with you. It doesn't have roots. Patriarchy has very deep roots. That's why I read out that judgment. It comes to you and then at times you forget about it. And then what stays with you is what you've always been familiar and comfortable with. For instance, there was a judgment a few years ago in which the defense, this was again a Supreme Court judgment, the defense had said that, you know, this woman has had, she's had other affairs and now she's alleging rape. And the court said things like, you cannot call her a loose woman, and it says, even a loose woman can be raped. Where does the word loose woman come from? What is this virtue attached to women? I've never heard of a loose man. So even when they're trying to talk about of being politically correct, actually the problem is that so deep-rooted is the cultural sensibility of patriarchy. And that is where the Khap Panchayat fits in. Of course, there are ways, aren't there things called banned organizations, which they do all the time under the law? I'm not saying it's a great idea. But aren't there ways in which the law, when it wants to, actually has ways and means of going after somebody? Has anybody ever heard of such a thing being done? No. Because those are areas where you are like, you know, these are organic cultural formations that society has. And of course, they have patriarchal roots.
Just adding to what Vrinda said, and I think discussion about language in the current context is not complete if we don't talk about trolling. So when I am trolled on Twitter, it's a serious problem because each time they say, okay, she's a concubine of Rahul Gandhi or she must have spread her legs got money and who she's sleeping with and why she do. I'm like, okay, at least say that I've been paid to do this story. Don't women need, can't be corrupt and don't they need money to do something wrong? Why should I always have to sleep with somebody to do something like this that offends people? And second thing is also the use of language, because I remember last year I done a profile of Akhilesh Yadav, and after that there were two responses. One was all the mainstream journalists in Lucknow said ki Akhilesh bhaiya ladki dekh ke interview to de diye lo ab jhelo, and the second thing was somebody from Akhilesh's office, I got this response ki dikhne mein thi bahut seedhi magar nikli bahut kameeni. So you know, this whole thing about character and how women are and how they use all these tropes and you know, and then eventually do their work is something, it's language, and obviously a lot of things that are unsaid. So
I mean, look at the term honey trap. I'm going to stop with that because I've been
told
to stop.
Just so that when you talk about money, film critics are always trolled. Ki kitne paise liye the, batao. Every single Saturday and Friday, I get 500 questions on Twitter saying, how much money did that guy pay you? So yes, wo paise wali baat. I also think if the people, if I had actually said yes, I would have been deeply rich today, not sitting here.
No, she would much rather have the money than be asked whether she's so-and-so's concubine. Paisa kam se kam koi cheez to hai, concubine age mein kya pada hai? Okay. Thank you everybody, and we have to stop now.